Welcome back to another edition of the Night Report podcast. I'm Mike Broadbent. Joining me once again is Richie Schneiderite. Richie, we're here to talk Iowa Rutgers Saturday night, big game in Piscataway. We have a guest coming on shortly. He is the host of the Locked On Iowa podcast. His name is Trent Condon. But first, this podcast is brought to you by Bet Online. Bet Online is the fastest and easiest way to wager on all your favorite sports contests and events with first to market odds and lines. You can find reviews for every league, including Major League Baseball, NFL, NBA, NHL, combat sports, esports, and even golf. BetOnline continues to be the top online resource for all your favorite sports information, from live in-game betting, props, and futures. You'd head to BetOnline today or use your mobile device to join today and make your first sports bet. Use our promo code BELEAV50, that's BLEAV50, to receive your 50% welcome bonus on your first deposit. BetOnline, where the game starts.
I know we don't have a ton of time today, but I gotta say, five-leg parlay yesterday with the Aaron Judge home run, Yankees over, Yankees spread. Oof.
Oh, my God. I had a same-game parlay that missed. It was like a six-game, same-game parlay that missed on 1 yard the other day.
Oh, yeah.
Man, A.J. Brown, over 70 yards. He had 69, so I would have won like $5,000.
That's why you bet on – you don't bet on the Eagles. But, hey, whatever.
It's been going pretty well so far.
Anyway, we're also sponsored by Adam Goldman, the franchise coach. If you don't know Adam, Adam is a 10-year veteran in the business. He's been kind of helping people just find a new American dream. Kind of if you're just bored with your same old day desk job all day, every day, that 9-to-5 just kind of killing you. You kind of want to create your own business. He's the guy you want to talk to. He's a Jersey guy, Night Report member, Scarlet Knights fan. I think we're going to have him on the pod next week to talk a little more in depth about what he does for I guess a little more of a better explanation than what I'm doing right now. But if you kind of want to change up your career, hit him up, 844-800-3726 or franchisecoach.net. He can kind of you can own your own business, and it's pretty easy, and he can help you out.
Yeah, it's going to be exciting to have him on so we can actually meet our fans. So this game, obviously, it's a 7 p.m. kickoff, first night game in the Big Ten for Rutgers, with fans in the stands since 2017, Ohio State. A lot of excitement around this game, obviously. It's looking like it's going to be a sellout. It sounds like there's starting to develop a pretty nice visitor list as well. Do you want to talk about a few of the top-level names that are going to be there? And if we get cut off, if Trent joins us, we're going to finish this talk at the end of the podcast, guys. So.
Yeah, so I mean, right away, obviously, a couple of the commits are going to be there. So far, Davon Fuse said he's going to be there. We talked to Jasir Patterson the other day. He's having a pretty good season for Union City so far. He's going to be there. John Stone, offensive line commit. There's an interesting 2023 in Zayden Michelle. He's a Holy Trinity guy. He really wants a PWO, and I think it's got pretty high potential that he might get one. Rutgers wants to build that relationship with Holy Trinity. Obviously, they have a couple dudes already. They have Braithwaite, who is going to try to get there. I'm not 100% sure if he'll be there or not. I know he suffered an unfortunate injury this past weekend, so he's out for the season, broken collarbone. It's a shame because he was having a pretty good year so far. Played a lot of defense, too, in this past game. Other than that, Nick Farisi, another Holy Trinity kid. Josiah Brown, obviously, was pretty close to committing at one point. It's very New York heavy right now. Caden Brown's coming up. That's huge, or coming down, I guess, from New York. It's very huge to get him on campus again. I wouldn't be shocked if he committed early. He just has a really good relationship with the staff. Watson's been working him really well. There's a bunch of names out there that are going to be on campus. So
awesome. And joining us, Trent Condon from the Locked On Iowa podcast. Trent, thanks so much for taking some time out of your schedule. I know you're busy to talk this game.
Yeah, looking forward to it, guys, and looking forward to Putathon 2022. Maybe the lowest total in college football history, at least over the last 22 years.
Yeah, the off-season showdown of the legs. Hopefully we see some nice boomers, maybe get downed on like the 1 or 2 yard line, really get the crowd going. But these two teams, it's kind of like a mirror image in a lot of ways. Like, we both have struggled offensively. We're both pretty upset with our offensive coordinators right now. We both have great defenses and elite punters. So we've had a lot of talk this week about why Rutgers fans are upset with Sean Gleason. Why are Iowa fans so upset with Brian Ferentz?
Well, there's a lot of elements to this. And you kind of start from the forefront of things. And Brian, as the offensive coordinator, did he even deserve the job 5 years ago? I think that was a big part of it. Kirk Ferentz, during his 24 years, offense has never been at the forefront. This has been a program that's been built on defense and special teams, and though they've had some moments offensively, it's never been great. Ken O'Keefe was his first offensive coordinator. He was there for 10 years before going on and becoming quarterback's coach with the Miami Dolphins. He was a guy that was maligned, but you kind of look back upon it and say, boy, what did we have there? Those were some offenses that could really do some things. Then it went into Greg Davis, who came in from Texas, where he was much maligned. It was a terrible marriage. It was a horizontal passing game with the zone blocking scheme. It never worked, though they had the 12-0 season in 2015. Overall, it was frustration. And then it goes to Brian, a guy that was a tight ends coach in New England. He then comes back to be offensive line coach at Iowa. Didn't have the resume. Look, if his name was Brian Jones, there's no way he would have been the offensive coordinator at Iowa. He just didn't have it, but it's not the case. And so you have this nepotism angle that is frustrating in its own right, and he's unfireable. This offense has been nothing short but brutal in his 5 years. The rushing game, which has always been at least a hallmark of Iowa football, they've been terrible. They've been in the 90s his first 2 years, 2020, the weird year, they were 58th in the country in rushing. And the last 2 years, 101st last season and 119th this year. It's just, it has not worked. And you know Iowa can't throw the football. Now you can't run the football. It just has never worked. And he'll never be fired because, well, his last name is Ferentz. There's no way that Kirk is going to fire his son. And it just feels like Hawkeye fans, we're just stuck here. We're just stuck watching this garbage and nothing will ever change.
I had no idea he was the OC for 5 years now. I thought it was just like he was promoted last year or something, and it was just, we're kind of tired of it. I could totally understand why you guys are just fed up at this point then. But speaking of the offense, you've obviously had some struggles at quarterback, same as us, but what happened to Spencer Petras? Like, he had a pretty good year according to PFF last year, but this year he's one of the worst 10 quarterbacks in terms of PFF grades. Like, his QBR is like 7 and the average is 50. Like, what's going on with this kid, and why is Iowa refusing to give somebody else a shot at the quarterback?
Well, and that's another very layered conversation. So with Petras, I've never been a fan. I've never felt that he is good enough. He is a statue in the pocket. He can't move around. He is maybe the least athletic quarterback I've seen at the Division I level in a long time. There's just no athleticism to him, coupled with a guy that has completely lost his confidence. First game of his career back in 2020, they opened up against Purdue. He threw for 260 yards. Since then, he's only gone over 225 once. That is throughout all of 2020, 2021, and here 3 games into 2020. It is a guy that struggles with confidence, a guy that can't move around, and a guy that I think is broken, but there's something. I don't know if he has pictures of the Ferentz family. I don't know what it is, but you know, a season ago, he gets banged up, and it was the Northwestern game. Struggled. He got 2 drives. You knew he was really banged up and was not able to move even less than normal, and they give the job to Alex Padilla. He comes in right away. The offense looks completely different. He's taking shots upfield. He's moving around. He's making plays. He's a little guy. He's listed at 6'1". He's probably 5'11", but he was making plays for them. They beat Minnesota as he's a starter there. They beat Illinois. They score, I think, 31 and 27 in those 2 games.
Wow.
He struggles in the first half against Nebraska, and it's right back to Petras, and that's where we are again. The other baffling thing about this is he had a quarterback that moved the football, a quarterback that certainly looked better last year in Padilla, and we were told it was going to be a competition this offseason. The other guy transferred. They looked around a little bit in the transfer market. I don't think they were heavily involved. I think that was more coach speak than anything, and to get the media and the fans off of Kirk's back a little bit when they said that. But it was never an open competition. There is something about Spencer Petras, even going back when he got the job in 2020. This is so un-Kirk Ferentz-like, where you have to earn your spot. You have to, each and every week, earn your spot. He was handed the reins after Nate Stanley graduated in 2019, something that has never happened before in his 24 years at the quarterback position. So it's just a odd marriage. There is something going on that he absolutely loves the guy, and he's not going to change. I've also heard Alex Padilla coming into this year maybe hasn't been as engaged, and obviously not getting a snap as the worst quarterback in the country through the first 3 games in Spencer Petras. I can understand, Padilla, why you're checking out and not going into the film room and maybe hanging out downtown a little bit more. You know, those kind of things, you can understand it, because, hey, if I can't play over the worst quarterback in the country, what's the point? I can completely understand where he's coming from.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so Padilla's kind of interesting to me, just because he has a little connection to Rutgers, sort of, because Gus Zielinski was one of his offensive linemen at Cherry Creek in Colorado. Mm-hmm. But shifting away from the quarterback, what a more offensive line talk. That's what Iowa's always been known for. It's always these big uglies up front. The recruiting rankings are there. What the hell's going on there?
It's baffling. It really is. And this is something that, in fact, Kirk talked about yesterday in his press conference, as he talked about, again, cut blocking. So with the zone scheme, you have to be able to cut block. I mean, you go back to the Denver Broncos in their heyday with Elway and Terrell Davis and company, when zone blocking really became to the front of the lexicon, I think, for football fans. And what you were able to see at that point in time is that cut block, that outside linebacker, the defensive end, you get a cut on them. It allows the cutback lane. You can't do that anymore in college football. And Kirk has complained about it for 5 years. This started in 2018. Here we are 5 years later. You still can't cut block the same way, yet they have not adapted the scheme. They haven't changed. And the offensive line is very young right now. With it, it's a very difficult zone scheme to pick up what you need to do, and the unison that you need to work through. They've been working through a bunch of different guys. 7-8 guys have seen significant snaps here. So it's kind of a twofold scenario. One, you're running a zone blocking scheme that doesn't work today in the college environment, coupled with a really young offensive line. You lose Linderbaum, you go to Logan Jones, who'd never been a center before. He was a defensive lineman a year ago. Now he's your center. A big step back there. Your tackles are, I think there's a lot of future hope for both of the guys that are playing at tackle, but both of those guys are still just sophomores in their campaign. The guards are very young too. I think eventually they're going to get there, but right now it's still a long ways to go. Now there's a guy, number zero, Dom Peterson for Nevada last week. Nevada, one of the worst defenses in the country. He was in the backfield all night long. It was one of those guys where you're struggling against Nevada. How are you going to be able to move the football against anybody in the Big Ten?
No, that's fair. I do want to talk about your skill position players as well. Sounds like Keegan Johnson made his first appearance of the season last week, and maybe he got a little banged up. It sounds like he's not expected to play this week. But you also had a breakout performance from your backup running back and Caleb Johnson. So tell us a little bit about who we should watch for on Saturday in terms of Iowa skill position players.
Yeah, so it looks like, yeah, Keegan Johnson's going to be out again this week. He is, last week was the first time he had practiced since December. Play in the bowl game, didn't go through spring practice. It's been a really weird scenario. Iowa has not been willing to really divulge much. There's been some speculation, hamstring injury, maybe there's a sports hernia injury also in there, and then a bunch of other things. And at Iowa, you got to practice to play, and some people may be thinking that Keegan didn't really want to be out there practicing real hard as he's coming back from these soft tissue injuries. So that's been a part of it. He comes back last week. Of course, he had the two delays in the game as it ends at 2:40, your guys' time out there on the East Coast as that thing finished up. After the first delay, though, he didn't come back into the game. We thought, well, maybe they're just keeping an eye on it. We find out this week he's not going to be there. We got a new name, though, and a guy from out in your guys' neck of the woods. It was Nico Reganey. That's what we've called him for the last 4 years. Okay. We found out yesterday in the press conference. We've been saying his name wrong for 4 years, and his dad's mad about it. It's an Italian name. We got to get it right. So it's Reganey, and we got to get that right. So Nico Reganey, he came back from a foot injury last week. He was really good, had a big play. He's more of a kind of possession type of receiver, but he's going to be their big play guy. Somebody to keep an eye on, though. He got a couple opportunities last week, didn't come up with a couple of deep balls, is Brody Brecht. He's a 6'4 wide receiver. He's also on the baseball team. Throws 99 miles an hour. He started the Big Ten championship game against Michigan. His future is obviously on the baseball field, but he grew up a Hawkeye fan, wanted to run out of the tunnel at Kinnick, and he's going to help them, I think, some deep shots up the field. Good size. He's also coming back a hamstring injury he sustained during summer baseball this year, but that's another one to keep an eye on. And then he mentioned Caleb Johnson in the run game. He was a godsend. Couple of long runs. We talked about the struggles in the game. Saw a couple of places out there that measure, you know, kind of the miles per hour that he's running. He was going 21.5 miles an hour on his second touchdown run.
Wow.
He can get up and go, and he is put together. He's 6'1", 215. They got him. He was committed to Cal. And was committed to Cal for a long time. An Ohio guy. I have some family out in Ohio. I knew a couple of high school coaches out there. They knew Ohio State was never going to offer, but they were baffled why the Penn States, the Michigans, the Wisconsins of the world were not after him. They absolutely loved him. Everybody I talked to out there, Iowa got a real gem in Caleb Johnson.
I mean, it's interesting. You guys got a ton of skill players, it sounds like, and just no offense. I guess it's end of the day.
It's a quarterback.
It's a quarterback. It's, OC.
You guys will see Petras, too. The thing about him is it's not, you know, a scheme. That's a part of it, absolutely. Mm-hmm. The offensive line struggles, but there are simple throws. The South Dakota State game, he sailed 8 passes over his receivers' heads. It's mechanics, footwork. The Boo Birds have been out from the get-go, and because of that, I think this is a guy that is just mentally broken. I don't know if there's any coming back from it. His best throws last week against Nevada were just taking shots up the field, and something they didn't do against Iowa State at all. They didn't attempt to pass over 10 yards in the game in the loss to Iowa State, which is just absolutely baffling. And you can't do that this week against you guys. I mean, you got to go out there and you got to take shots up the field. When he does that, he's a lot better. But those timing routes, simple out routes up the seam, those are where he is really struggling right now and struggling with accuracy. His footwork's a mess. There's all kinds of problems with him. And you'll see it. You'll probably see it all game long. No matter how bad he plays, he'll continue to be trotted out there.
So I mean, worst offense in the country, but one of the best defenses. Is this the best defense you've ever seen? I mean, Jack Campbell's pretty good. Riley Moss is a freak, according to Bruce Feldman.
First team All-Americans, pretty good. Yeah, I guess.
I mean, Rutgers has one. They got a punter.
Yeah, we got a punter.
First team All-American.
We're fighting right behind with our guy, Torrey Taylor. Yeah, this defense, I'm not ready to put it at the elite category, and that's what this program has been built on. It is defense and what they did with Norm Parker, the old defensive coordinator, now Phil Parker. No relation, but he took over and has really adapted and changed it and taken the scheme to the 21st century. What they're able to do up front, and they're a little banged up there. Noah Shannon, one of their starting defensive tackles, only played 5 snaps last week, and he might be a guy that is limited if he does go this week. But they are so deep at the defensive line position. I think it was 7-8 years ago. Iowa had a really good team right at the turn of the century. 2009 went to the Orange Bowl, preseason top 10 team in 2010. And they lost a lot of close games in 2010 because they only played 4 defensive linemen. And they went to Georgia. They talked to them. They said, if you want to compete at the defense, you got to get depth there. And they've done that. They have 10 guys that they are very confident with at that defensive line. If it isn't Noah Shannon this week, a defensive tackle, you'll see a guy named Lucas Van Ness. He was a guy out of Illinois, not a real highly regarded guy coming out of high school. He is Hercules. I mean, this guy is an absolute monster. 6'4", 280, not an ounce of fat on him. He likes to, of course, roll up the shirt a little bit and show off those abs. He is a behemoth. He'll be playing inside. He plays outside as well. He comes in, plays defensive tackle. But the depth is what really sets them apart. You mentioned Campbell at the linebacker spot. He is. He's worth the price of admission. He is an old-school middle linebacker, rangy, 6'4", will make plays all over the field. And the biggest maybe surprise this year has been at cornerback. They had an injury before the season. One of their starting corners was out. Cooper DeJean has come in. He's been the guy as they run their cash position, kind of a nickel slot guy that goes out there. But he's been also playing a lot of cornerback. He is a 6'1", ridiculous athlete. He played quarterback in high school, small school, up in northwest Iowa, won the state championship in football. He's drop-step dunking over kids at the high school level when he was playing at 6'1". He is a freak athlete. He's going to be on the freaks list for Feldman coming up next year. He is absolutely ridiculous, and maybe the next Jason Sehorn. We don't see a whole lot of guys that look like us playing cornerback in the NFL.
I was going to say.
Cooper DeJean.
Yeah, I was going to drop
that. He's got that opportunity.
I'm sure you've heard a lot of Jason Sehorn talk around Riley Moss. Yes. And now Cooper. Is Cooper DeJean another white corner? I guess that's what you're saying.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
You guys got dudes at every level of the defense. Like, you guys got guys with 75 plus grades at every level of your defense. So, and multiple of them. Like you said, there's a lot of depth on this defense. I think they're going to give Rutgers a lot of trouble this weekend.
They do. Defensive backfield's played really well. Iowa's also had the free safety year after year. It's kind of this try-hard walk-on guy, right? We like to call them the Tommy Soybeans that are out there and worked hard, got their chance late in their career. They got another one in Quinn Schulte, but he's a little bit different. I mean, he packs a pop. He's got physicality. He had 4 pass breakups in the first game against South Dakota State. He's a little bit different, plays at a different speed than some of the guys that we've seen in the past. And then Kayvon Merriweather, he's been a 3-year starter. He's really, really good. He's one of the captains of this team. So defensively, it's really, really difficult to find a crack in this defense. And I think that's why we're maybe setting up for one of the lowest scoring games, certainly, of the season.
Did you say, this is bothering me, did you say they're not elite?
The defense?
No. Oh, absolutely.
I was going to say, right. I thought you said not elite. I was like, what the hell is he talking about?
I'm not ready to put him up there. Some of the best defenses, 2004, 2009 of the Ferentz era. They still got a little work to do to get there, but yeah, 3 games in. And again, the 3 teams that they played. South Dakota State wasn't able to do a whole lot. Iowa State, they have limitations offensively. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, last week against Nevada. So got to see the competition ramp up a little bit more before I'm ready to put them up in that rarefied era of the great Hawkeye defenses.
Sure.
Perfectly fair.
So the Big Ten, it boasts some of the best home experiences in terms of stadiums that kind of exist in the country. Rutgers hasn't really had a big-time home game in a while. We had a few at the beginning of our Big Ten membership with the first game we played against Penn State, and then we had the night game against Michigan. So this is going to be probably the best environment at SHI Stadium in almost 10 years. It's Iowa's first road game of the season. Do either of those things worry the Hawkeyes? Because I think it's easy to underplay that it's going to be like, oh, it's Rutgers, but it's really going to be a crazy environment this weekend.
Yeah, did I hear this is the first night game that they've had in like 4 or 5 years, something like that?
2017.
Yeah, yep.
2017, yeah. Wow. So fans. It has been a while. So my biggest concern about that is certainly the offensive line play. I mentioned earlier how young they are up front, and you got a new center out there. One weird thing, too, about Logan Jones, the center, is we've seen a ton of times this year in all three games where it feels like the cadence is off or he's slow snapping the ball. Guys are getting maybe a jump start, it feels like, at the tackle spot because the ball's not getting back there. Now you couple that with a road environment. It's going to be loud in there. A quarterback that has struggled this season and struggled with confidence. Yeah, I think this is setting up to be a really, really scary matchup here because as good as the defense is, you still got to be able to score. And I just don't know if I was going to be able to do it again this week.
Mm-hmm. So I know there's not a ton of similarities between the two programs, but there is one interesting one in terms of recruiting. Marco Lane's QB commit, Jersey guy. Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts on him overall? And is he the future, or is, I want to say, I guess you got Lavish, you got May in the past two classes, you got Padilla who's still there. Is that like, is what you guys are kind of banking on? Is it like Lane's future? This is it?
Well, I think people are already looking to 2024, so they got a kid out of Florida that is athletic, can actually move around. So there's excitement. And I know that Lyonnais is a guy that can also move around. For me, do you guys know Tony Rapiopi, his quarterback coach?
Yeah, Rapiopi, yeah.
Yeah, so Rasiopi's also been working for the last 3 years with Spencer Petras. To be frank, I'm super nervous about that. You know, you watch the workouts with Padilla, and it's all right. You're gonna fly right, slap left. He's throwing a slant route. I think he does too much, putting too many things in the guy's head. Just let the kids throw the ball. And because of that, for Lyonnais, I'm kind of concerned because of his quarterback coach, just because of what we've seen with Petras. So that's where I am. Yeah, people are already looking to 2024 and the kid out of Florida, hoping, hey, we got a fast guy in there, a guy that can move around a little bit. Maybe that'll be the future. We'll see about that. But quarterback recruiting, it's so interesting and the way that they've done it. But Rasiopi and me, I guess we're not real tight right now.
I mean, he's hit or miss. He's got Kenny Pickett on his resume. He's got Jarek Guarantano, who made the league. I mean, Art Sikowski, who's kind of dog shit, but...
Mm-hmm. I want to ask you something before we ask for your kind of prediction on how this game's going to go. You guys were kind of like the center of the college football meme universe a couple weeks ago when the cameos started coming out from Fran McCaffrey, who I should have probably known better, but a guy like Bob Stoops, I can get it. What has that been like to live? And like, that was one of the funniest things I've seen college football fans do in a while.
And how many did you
pay
for?
It was a great... Well, I would have thought about it. Yeah, I might have had one to talk about our quarterback too. But it was a fun night when they kind of needed it, right? Mm-hmm. It was so much frustration inside the fan base. It was something a little bit different. It was goofy. It was silly. I was a little bit surprised. So I have my former roommate. His wife works in the athletic department. And the emails that were flying around that Monday night, you know, how are we going to, what are we going to talk about? And they just let it slide. You know, they, outside of Fran McCaffrey coming out with a statement, there wasn't a whole lot that was done there. It was absolutely hilarious. Whoever did that, I mean, kudos to you.
It was such a funny moment. They did it.
It was, absolutely. Yeah. And it's something that a lot of the fan base is certainly thinking. Brian, go back to New England, get out of here. He was not alone in that thinking. And Bob Stoops is a beloved figure. Bob Stoops, back when he was the Florida defensive coordinator, everybody believed after Hayden Fry retired that he was going to be the guy. He was a safety at Iowa. His brothers all played at Iowa. He was a beloved figure, and it felt like a foregone conclusion that Bob Stoops was going to be the Iowa coach. He came and took his interview. After his interview, they said, we still have one more person that we are going to interview. We promised to interview to. It turned out to be Kirk Ferentz. But in the interim, after they brought in Kirk the next day, Bobby Stoops went down to Oklahoma and took the Oklahoma job, of course. And before it could even be offered officially to him, he had already signed on with the Sooners. So there's always a lot of what if, you know, how different this program would be. Even with the great success that Kirk Ferentz has had and what he's done with this program, there's always that thinking, man, what could have been if Bob Stoops would have decided to come back home and become the Hawkeye coach?
For sure. So I guess, how do you see this game going? It kind of has the feel of whoever wins, like, the turnover battle might end up taking this one. Mm-hmm. Whoever scores the most on defense might take this one. How do you see it going?
I love the under. I know it's silly, and it's probably a square play, but I'm all over it. 34.5 between these two teams. I mean, can you envision a scenario outside of a bunch of defensive scores that this thing is more than 13-10? I cannot come up with a realistic scenario for either side where short fields and a defensive score, they're going to be moving. With the great punters that are out there, it's going to be a field position game. I think we're destined to 12-10, 13-9, and something like that. It's going to be ugly. Maybe there'll be a safety in there, and we'll get 11-8, and everybody can make fun of us across the college football landscape on Saturday night. It's going to be a slugfest. It's going to be old school. I think it's going to be a good one. Ultimately, I got you guys pulling it out. I'm going to go Rutgers 13-9.
Wow. Okay.
So Big Ten football right there.
A lot of our fans are similarly down in the dumps that it's like, how is this offense going to beat anybody moving forward? So it sounds like we're just all kind of hating on our own teams right now. But is there anything else you had for Trent, Richie, or anything you'd like to plug, Trent?
Yeah, I got one thing for you real quick. Are you coming out to Jersey this weekend or...?
I'm not, no. Unfortunately, not going to be able to make it out there. Got Ohio State on the docket, so I'm going to be going out to that one. And I've been to every Big Ten stadium as a fan. Now, I've been a media member for 20 years, but when I travel, I do it as a fan. And I've been to every Big Ten stadium, except for you two newbies. Haven't been out to Maryland and haven't been to Rutgers, but hopefully be able to cross that off the list here sometime pretty soon. In fact, I've never even been to New York or New Jersey, so definitely got to make that a full, you know, make it a 4 or 5 day kind of weekend type of thing and hit all the hot spots. Some of my friends that are going out there, though, and they're taking the train to the game, they're a little bit nervous about heading back to the city afterwards, getting back. That late train, I've heard, is a little rough getting back to the city.
It's a pain in the ass, I'll tell you that much. But I was asking you more for, I wanted to know if you ever had New Jersey corn, just because it's like 10 times better than Iowa corn, from what I'm being told.
No.
From what I'm being told.
Oh, no.
Sources say.
Hey, you can rip on our corn all you want, because I don't like corn. So it's all good. It's all good.
You're not
right. I know. That's what I've heard many times. I've tried. Just doesn't hit for me.
God.
All right. Well, Trent, where can we find you on social media? And tell us a little bit about your podcast as well before you sign off.
Yeah, you can find me at Trent Condon. I'll be complaining during the game a lot of that throughout. I do the Locked On Hawkeyes podcast every day, talking Hawkeyes on that front with Locked On. And then I also host a daily radio show here in Des Moines on KXNO 106.3 FM and 1460 AM from 10 to noon. So I have that going on as well. So always busy, a lot of Hawkeye talk. We also we have to talk Cyclones in our markets and do that. But it's pretty cool. We get the marriage of the Big Ten and Big 12. We get to talk about two major conferences, which is awesome. And you guys out there, of course, you got your pro sports teams. We're really cool in our market. We have four NFL teams that really matter, all kind of split the fan base between the Chiefs, the Bears, the Packers, and the Vikings. Same thing with baseball. So I'm a Twins fan. If there's summer they suck, we don't have to talk about the Twins. My Bears are terrible. We don't have to talk about them. So it's a really fun market to talk sports in.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much once again for joining us. It's been great to hear from an Iowa expert's perspective on how this game might go and all about your team. So thanks again, Trent.
All right. Thanks, guys.
All right. See ya.
I mean, that was pretty interesting. Some good stuff right there.
Yeah, no, a lot of good insight from Trent. We did kind of get into recruiting talk, and I want to finish that up. So let's just kind of restart. Where are we looking as a visitor list for this upcoming game?
It's still pretty early. Like I said, there's a couple big names, couple commits. The biggest names would probably be Caden Brown, Rasmus Hall, probably New York's top recruit. It's hard to argue that one because Josiah Brown's pretty damn good too, but he'll be there as well. Those two, I mean, like I said before, Josiah was close to committing at one point, so it wouldn't shock me if he was going to commit again, because he did make a couple more visits. He did visit the Notre Dames, the Penn States, I think Michigan State too at one point. Luka Jemma is one to really keep an eye on. He's actually an intriguing linebacker prospect in 2024. I know some of the other network sites, whatever you want to call them, they have him ranked in the top 20 in the state, which I tend to agree with. I think he might be like top 15 around there. He's pretty good out of Ramsey High School. Ramsey's been starting to get a little bit better and better each year, so he's one to watch. Michael Thomas III, Donovan Catholic kid. He was on campus last weekend or 2 weekends ago for Wagner. Got an offer, and he's coming back again. He's actually a Sayreville native, but he's obviously playing down at Donovan Catholic. So that's big right there. His uncle, Sean Thomas, is like one of the best ever I've ever seen at Sayreville growing up. Obviously, I was pretty young watching the Sayreville team, but he might be better than him. So put it like that.
Wow.
So and then Samaj Fuse, another 2026 O-line out of Ramsey, and Max Horder. Basically, that's the list for now. We have a running list going on the message boards. It's going to be updated every hour, probably, give or take. I know, obviously, a ton more names are going to come out. I'd be shocked if this list wasn't 50 deep by the Friday night, I would say, around then. Interestingly enough, I know Syracuse is making a push for some of these guys. Like, they got Caden Brown coming up on Friday, and then he's going to Rutgers on Saturday. So, I mean, it's crazy for some of these recruits. They're making – there was a recruit last week that made a Michigan and Ohio State visit in the same day. And it's just, like, it's absolutely insane. But same exact day. It was – you know who it was? It was Notre Dame and Michigan. That's what it was. It was Jake Guarnera. I don't know, however you say it. He's dad was a Rutgers guy. Out of Florida, though, right now. But regardless, this visitor list is going to be pretty big. It's going to be a big game for Rutgers. I'm going to get there early because I'm probably going to go eat some of that boardwalk food real quick and be a fat ass. And then hightail it in there. Get there early. Get there right at kickoff. If you're not, you're probably going to miss something because that might be one of the only chances that either team has to score. So...
Yeah, that's fair. I wish I was going to be able to make it. I'm going to be in Europe starting tomorrow.
I got to record the pod by myself.
Yeah, you gotta
find a guest.
I'll leave $20 on the counter. You can order some pizza or something. Just don't burn the place down.
I can't guarantee that one.
Well, if you guys, don't hear from us ever again, it's been fun doing the podcast. I'm sure we'll be fine.
Yeah, I'll get Alex on and we'll be good.
Yeah, but guys, this has been a fun week of covering Rutgers. Stay tuned to the boards because obviously that visitor list is going to keep growing. There might be some random news that pops up before the game, but let's go Knights and let's get to 4-0. Because I really do feel like this is a program-defining game, even though it sounds stupid. But this is kind of like a good resetting point for Shiano 2.0 because he hasn't had this big-time environment yet. As Rutgers coach the second time around, he's finally getting it. He's got the program on the upswing. Clearly, second year in row, they started 3-0 before they entered into a brutal Big Ten slate. Hopefully that slate gets a little easier moving forward with divisions evaporating. But this is really a huge moment in Rutgers sports history. And it sounds hyperbolic, but it's not. This is a massive, massive opportunity because we could follow it up with another night game against Nebraska in 2 weeks because I don't think we stand a chance against Ohio State. But if we have two awesome environments in a row, that could really just be a great resetting point for Rutgers football. Sorry for the monologue there.
No. But, hey, by all means, we're a hype man over here.
All right, so be there, wear red. And we'll see. Some of us will see you on Saturday. Go Knights. This has been another edition of the Night Report Podcast, signing off.